Good morning. Happy Easter. It's been the tradition of the church for over 2,000 years that I say he's risen and you say he's risen indeed. Are you ready? He's risen.
He's risen indeed.
We are not celebrating today an event that happened a long time ago because Jesus is here with us today. It is always Easter. Amen, church?
Amen.
I want to draw your attention to this wonderful handout. It indicates some ways you can grow and serve and connect with what we do here in the church in Jesus' name, including some wonderful classes that will be starting this Wednesday. Love and Logic for You Parents, A Way to Get Closer to God, taught by Leslie and Scott Turner, along with two other terrific couples in our congregation. And then How to Read the Bible with Dr. Phil Eaton, university president, now retired. Don't miss those opportunities. We encourage you to go to vpc.church, see all the other ways that you can grow, connect, and serve in our midst. This is a place where we want you to belong. If you don't have a church community, you don't have a place to really call your own and participate in. We hope that it'll be this church. If you have questions about that and want to talk to a pastor, please do that after the service or at any time. Call us or one of our adults who's at our welcome stand after the church.
Church, as you're able, will you please stand with me? Join me in our morning's call to worship. Love's redeeming work is done.
He fought the fight, the battle won.
The sun has shone, the darkness fled.
Crucified, no longer dead.
Vain the guard, the stone, the grave.
Our precious Lord has risen to save.
Let heaven and earth be moved to sing.
Glory, hallelujah, to our King.
Amen.
Thank you.
may be seated. Church, our wonderful gift of naming Jesus as Lord of our lives is that God forgives when we choose to confess those attitudes, behaviors, and actions that would keep us from Him. And when we confess, our God chooses to forgive, filling us up with love and mercy so we can be a people of grace, love, and mercy into this world. So here now in the stillness of this moment, let's come before our Lord, seeking forgiveness for those times where we have fallen short of that high calling placed before us. And together, God's people prayed our morning prayer of confession is found on our screens. Gracious God, You have occupied a small space in our thoughts and lives. You have been an occasional friend. We have not consulted You in decisions, honored You in investments, or put You in the center of our hearts and relationships. Forgive us. May we know You more clearly, love You more dearly, and follow You more nearly. We ask in the name of Jesus, who has risen and reigns. Amen. Church, receive this wonderful news as promised to us in our holy scriptures, that God so loved this world that He sent His only Son, not to condemn us, but to save us and to set us free. Church, rejoice, for in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen.
happy day indeed. I am so grateful to be here to give the children's message. I always enjoy speaking to the children who are here with us and those who are children at heart. I bet some of you have hunted for Easter eggs already this morning, and that feels a little bit like a mystery, like hunting for clues. So I have my Easter basket, and I brought my detective hat and my magnifying glass. I wonder how many of you like mysteries. I know there are some people who love mystery books, like classic mysteries, Nancy Drew and Hardy Boys, can't go wrong with them. Magic Tree House is also a long-standing favorite. TV shows have mysteries in them too, like Scooby-Doo, another classic that's still around. PJ Masks, Spidey and His Amazing Friends. All of these mysteries have something in common. They're trying to find the answer to a question, and they are looking for clues. So I am told that there are some clues up here for me today that are hidden in giant Easter eggs. And I wonder if you could help me by kind of directing me warm or colder to find them. I need to find first the pink egg. So can you kind of help me out if I'm going this way? Is this the right way to get to the pink egg? Is this the right way? Ah, here it is, the pink egg. It was so, thank you for your help. I would have never found it without you. Let's see what's inside this pink egg. Ooh, this is an important part of the Easter story. The crown of thorns. This reminds me about the part of the story where Jesus came into Jerusalem and people were so angry, they didn't understand what kind of king that he really was. And they had him arrested, he was hurt, and he was made to wear a crown of thorns. Well, let's see. I think the next egg I'm supposed to find is green. Can you guys help me with the green egg? Is it over here? Yay. Here's the green egg. What's going to be in this one? Oof. Oh, another great clue to tell the Easter story. The cross. This reminds me of how Jesus died. They hung him on a cross, and he died there to pay for all of our sins. But that's not the end of the Easter story. Let's see, we have one more egg, the blue egg. I don't know, where's the blue egg? I'm getting colder over here. Oh, over this way? Thank you. Thank you. I'm always glad to have help. So let's see what's in this last egg. It's empty. What? I know, right? It's a little surprising, but I bet if you think about it, you might know why it is empty. This empty egg reminds me of the empty tomb. See, after they took Jesus' body down from the cross and they placed it in a tomb, and 3 days later, some of the women who had been with Jesus, they went to the tomb that first Easter morning and found that it was empty. And it was a mystery, just like this egg at first. But then an angel came to them and helped them solve that mystery. The angel told them, he is not here. He has risen, just like he said he would. And see, for us, this empty egg and the empty tomb are not a mystery because we know how the story ended. Jesus Christ is alive today. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the fun of hunting for Easter eggs, but the reminders of how hard the Easter story was. But in the end, what a joy, what great news. The tomb is empty, and Jesus Christ is risen. Thank you for that, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, so children 3 years old and older are in worship with us today. We do have worship packets in the back if they'd like them. I invite the rest of you all to please greet one another in the time-honored Easter greeting. He is risen. He is risen indeed.
As we come to this time of prayer, I invite you to just take a moment, just to be with God for just a moment, and then I'm going to lead us in our time of prayer together. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, on this Easter morning, we joyfully give thanks for our risen Lord. We praise the name of Jesus, for he lives. For the grave could not contain him, and death did not have the final word. Jesus is alive. Our debt of sin has been paid, and he is open for all who seek him, life like we've never known, not only in this life, but also in the life to come. Lord, today we thank you that you've made all things new. And we ask that your work of change, your work of renewal would touch us at our deepest need. Lord, we remember how the women who'd followed our Lord had gone to his tomb at dawn on that first Sunday with the burial spices they'd prepared only to experience the unexplainable, as the stone that had sealed the entrance of the tomb had been rolled away, and looking inside, the tomb was empty. And then they heard the words, "Do not be afraid." Lord, as we remember these words, help us to hand to you those things in our life that cause us anxiety and leave us living in fear. Help us to live in the confidence that you are truly with us. And then the women heard the words, "He has risen." Lord, thank you that you keep your promises and remind us when doubts about you creep into our lives, doubts about how you're at work, doubts about whether you care, that you are faithful and love us more than we could ever imagine. And if that's not enough, the women were invited to tell others of this great news. Lord, as you invited the women to experience the wonder of the resurrection, you invite each of us today to come and to experience the wonder of your presence and power at work. Stir within each of us the desire to know you more, the desire to experience your love, a love that we don't have to earn, and a peace that's beyond anything that this world could ever offer. Lord, open our hearts to the unexplainable, to the resurrection that defies death, to the hope that is beyond what we can see. Lord, on this day, we celebrate that your Son lives, and because of that, we too live. And we praise you for this hope in the name of our risen and glorious Lord, Jesus the Christ, who taught us how to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Amen. You know, Easter is about celebrating the greatest gift that we could ever be given. This morning, we're joining our voices together to express our joy. But with this amazing news of Easter and the life-transforming power that it brings, this news is not something we just hold to ourselves. This news is something that we need to share with our community. They need to hear about this as well. And our faith giving is one way that we can tell this story of God's great love for us. So with that in mind, let's continue our worshiping of our great God through our offerings.
Moon and the stars and the sun, and they keep the living daylight.
God of life and hope, we come to you filled with joy by your life-transforming love. Through Christ, you have broken the bonds of oppression and have removed all barriers to your unending love. You've made us free to give you praise and thanksgiving. So use these gifts as tokens of our gratitude and use us as well for your glory. All praise and honor are yours. These things we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Friends, there is something very exciting about Easter. Even on a cold, wet Arizona day, you made it. Give yourselves a round of applause. Pastors also get excited for Easter, no surprise. And my friend, Reverend Dr. Doug Brower, was working one Saturday on his Easter sermon. He had set it up so there was no one else in the church. He had total silence. He had the hours for the services recorded. So when people called, and a lot of people call on Saturday before Easter Sunday to get the service times that aren't regular attenders, that it would be answered and automatically given. But he forgot in the moment of working on his sermon, he was concentrating, the phone rang, and he picked up the phone and he answered, "Hi, this is Doug." And the person said, "Well, when are the services?" He said, 9 and 11, but you better come early to get your seats. And he started to hang up, but the person said, "Speaking of seats, what are the pews like? Are they comfortable?" And he said, "Oh, yes, they're pretty comfortable." And he said, "Well, good. I hate it when the pews aren't comfortable." He said, "Well, is the music any good?" Doug said, "Well, it's good. They have a pretty good, not as good as this choir, but pretty good." And he said, "Well, are they going to sing anything that I'll know? Are they going to sing the Hallelujah Chorus?" He said, "Yes, they are. They're going to sing the Hallelujah Chorus." Terrific. Doug started to put the phone down. He said, "Wait a minute. I want to ask about the sermon. Is the preacher any good?" And Doug said, "Well, I don't know if he's even going to finish at this rate, but he's working hard to get there." And the guy said to him, "Well, I just have, you know, this one more question for you that I want to ask you today. What's the sermon about?" And Doug, now losing his patience, he said, "It's the same old story. The same old story you hear every Easter. You know, rock moves, ground quakes, soldiers faint. The greatest person in history comes back from the dead. Same old story." Well, friends, get ready to listen to the same old story. Here it is from Mark chapter 16. When the Sabbath was over and Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had bought the spices, they did so they might go and anoint the body. And so very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had just risen, they went to the tomb. Now, they had been saying to one another as they walked, "Who's going to roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He's not here. Look, there's the place that they laid him. So go and tell his disciples and Peter that he's going ahead of you into Galilee, and there you'll see him just as he said." So these women went out and they fled from the tomb. Terror and amazement had gripped them, and they didn't say anything to anyone for a while, for they were afraid. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, take this old story and give it for us as individuals, a present tense. Help us to discover again what it means that it's always Easter. We ask this in your son's name, and all God's people said. Amen. Well, I love the deerstalker hat that Tina used. It reminded me of a story about Sherlock Holmes. You know, Sherlock Holmes was also a hiker and a camper. And he and Dr. Watson were a trip in the Outer Hebrides, kind of a remote place, and it was nighttime, and they were sleeping in their tent, when suddenly Holmes woke up, and he woke up Watson, and he said, "Watson, what do you see?" Watson looked up in the sky. He said, "I see lots and lots of stars, Holmes." And Holmes said, "Well, what do you deduce from these stars that you see, Watson?" And Watson said, "Well, from an astronomical point of view, I deduce that there are innumerable planets and galaxies. And chronologically, I deduce, looking up there, it's about 3:10 a.m. And theologically, I deduce that God is a vast creator and we are finite, tiny creatures. And meteorologically, I deduce that it's going to be a beautiful day tomorrow. Look how clear the sky is, Holmes." And then he said, "Holmes, what do you see?" And Holmes said, "I see that you are an idiot, Watson. because I deduce that someone has stolen our tent. You know, the art of reason is to draw the relevant conclusions, to draw the right deductions from the facts that you face. Now, Holmes famously said that when you're dealing with a mystery, when you eliminate the impossible, then whatever remains, no matter how improbable, how unlikely, it must be the truth. So today I want to appoint you as experts in popularity. Imagine that you are given the job of determining who the most popular, adored figures are in every field. What criteria would you use? How many followers they have online? The power of their brand? The number of people who recognize their name? There could be all kinds of criteria. But I think we know that in every field, there are likely candidates, people who just lead in adoration. Let's take actors for a moment. You know the actors that have sold the most total receipts in history? We've got one up here. It's Robert Downey Jr. He's number one, $16 billion worth. Number two, surprise me, it's Scarlett Johansson, $15 billion worth. And then the third one is Samuel L. Jackson, $14 billion. But, you know, to be fair to people, how many of you loved actors from a previous era? I know we have some nostalgic fans out there. You know, when tickets were selling for 10 cents, it's hard to get to the top of the receipts, right? No video resales, no downloads. So we're going to look at this guy. He sold 1 billion tickets, which is quite a thing to think in his time. Clark Gable, and so did John Wayne, and so did Bing Crosby right there. We were going to count them as well. They had a lot of adulation, a lot of acclaim. How about athletes? LeBron James is the most popular athlete in America, but the most recognized is still a guy who hasn't dunked or shot a basketball for a long time professionally, and that's Michael Jordan. He's still the most recognized, 98%. But that's not Michael Jordan. You jumped the gun a little back there. But this guy is actually more popular right now than either of those guys. This is Lionel Messi, and 4 billion people have watched some of his games or highlights this year, including me. And I have to mention his rival, Ronaldo. He wasn't watched as much, but he was followed by 500 million people on social media, the two most popular athletes around the world. Now, what about singers in groups? Can you guess the group that sold the most albums? Oh, you're on it. Let's have the Fab Four right there. Those Liverpudlians, 420 million albums. But in terms of solo artists, the most is Michael Jackson, quickly followed up by Elvis. And I give Elvis a little extra credit because he has more imitators than Michael Jackson. And also, his home, Graceland, is really now like a religious shrine in the South. That's what I'm told. How about ladies? We don't want to leave the ladies out. The most popular lady of all time is Madonna. Let's see if we can get her up there. The queen of pop, 250 million albums. But she is being rapidly overtaken, don't show it yet, by another person. And that person, can you guess? Taylor Swift. The Swifties are in the house today on Easter. Let's show her. There she is. 180 million albums so far and counting. Now, some of you aren't interested in all this pop stuff. You're readers, intellectuals. Well, who's the most popular author of all time? Would you guess? If you love, I'll give you a hint. It's a mystery writer, but not Arthur Conan Doyle. Agatha Christie. There she is, the Dame Agatha Christie. 2 billion books she sold. She put Shakespeare into second place. I don't know what that says about us as people that read books. And then the third person would be this gal here. This is Danielle Steele, for those of you that love romance. Now, we could expand these categories, right? We could look at business leaders and entrepreneurs. We could look at scientists and inventors, and we come up with names, and you'd be able to guess them, Galileo and Copernicus and Newton and Einstein and Louis Pasteur and Darwin and Ford and Rockefeller and Jobs and Walton and all these other folks. Why do we know all these names? Because the likely leaders in adoration are pretty obvious. They have an incredible talent to entertain or to enthrall or to compete. They change the landscape when it comes to business or economics or our intellects, right? But isn't it interesting that you could add up all the metrics for everyone that I just mentioned, and many more, and surprise, 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 they would all come a distant second, collectively, to this other person for whom there have been universities and schools founded in his name in every continent. There have been cathedrals constructed in his honor. He is the central figure in the best-selling book of every year and of all time, which is the Bible. He's the most studied. He's the most debated. He is the most influential character in history. Songs are sung not just on Easter, but every day, and indeed written and composed every day all around the world to glorify his name. Does anyone doubt that Jesus is the most followed person of all time? Not just online, but actually in life. People want to imitate him, not for a day in an Elvis costume, but every moment of their lives. By every measure, he is the leader in adoration, admiration, adulation, and acclaim, right? And yet, he is the most unlikely leader of adoration of all. Now, I'm going to need you to respond a little bit. I want this section of the church and the balcony, you're not relieved of this duty balcony. I'm going to say how unlikely, and you guys are going to say very. We're going to practice. How unlikely?
Very.
And the rest of you are going to say unlikely. We're going to practice again. How unlikely?
Very.
Oh, you guys are good. Excellent. It's unlikely that Jesus would be a hero. Why? Well, he was a Jew, and the Jews were a despised nation. I mean, the Romans looked at them with a combination of kind of curiosity and contempt. Now, Jesus was not only a Jew, but he lived at the far extreme of the Roman Empire and in a town that is so obscure, it isn't even mentioned in the Torah. Nazareth's not mentioned. Some people challenged the idea that it was real till archaeologists found it. And when they found it was so small and only had 120 families in Jesus' day. Jesus, for 91% of his life, for 30 out of 33 years, was just an ordinary guy. No one knew he was there except people in Nazareth. He worked as a carpenter. And then for 36 months, a short time, he had a public ministry, and he never went more than 30 miles from his hometown. It's incredible that he's a hero, that he's adored. I mean, think about it. He had no degrees, had no official recognition. He had no approval, no real credentials. There's no physical description of him in the Bible. He was rejected by the majority of people in his own hometown of Nazareth and by almost all the official leadership of the nation of Israel, who eventually tried him as a criminal and had him condemned by his own people, sentenced by the Romans. He was tortured and executed in the way they executed on a cross the scum of the empire. How unlikely?
Very unlikely
as a hero. And he formed an unlikely community. Very unlikely. One-third of the disciples were fishermen, all right? How unlikely is that? Very few of them had any education. Matthew did, but he was a tax collector, the most hated of all people. In the broader Christian community that Jesus gathered, not many people could get their resume listed on Indeed. I mean, they were former lepers and beggars, people who'd been blind or lame or deaf or dumb. They were busy trying to learn to walk again or communicate again after years of silence or immobility. Jesus brought together the friendless and the excluded, and then the morally compromised, like prostitutes. These people had no power and no resources and no social position. Paul was way too honest with his congregation in Corinth. You'll never hear me say this to anyone in Paradise Valley. He said this, "Not many of you were wise or powerful or influential or highborn. God chose the weak and the foolish to shame the wise and the strong. He chose the low and the despised." How unlikely? A very unlikely community for this very unlikely hero. And they had a very unlikely message. The cross is the symbol of Christianity. The cross was a symbol of intimidation and fear. It was this hated instrument that the Romans used to intimidate people all over their vast empire to keep them subject. Imagine if our final hymn was "Lift High the Electric Chair" today. You think I'd get a few letters from people in the congregation? Or if we sang, "When I Survey the Wondrous Guillotine," create a little controversy? It might, but it shouldn't, because neither of those methods of death are half as terrifying as being crucified. It was a stumbling block to Jews. It was foolishness to everyone else. By the very word resurrection that we're using today, that word, it didn't refer to one person like Jesus being raised in the middle of history. It had a definite meaning. It meant at the end of time, all the dead would be raised, and God would bring peace and security, the end of wars, the end of diseases. History would come to this marvelous climax. There'd be a new age. No one would even thought of using this word in the first century to describe the resurrection of one person in the middle of history. It was an unlikely message. How unlikely? Unlikely message from an unlikely community about an unlikely hero. It had an unlikely spread and an unlikely victory. How many of you have ever been involved in a political campaign? Have you ever done that at all? You ever cheered for a candidate? Maybe some of you have even been to that party where you're waiting the election results, the drama of it. You know, they're coming in slowly. You're getting a sense, are we winning? Are we losing? Some of you may have been in a room like I've been in where the news is not good. The tally is there and your candidate has lost. And he or she has to stand up and make a concession speech, to pull the second speech out of their pocket and admit that it's all over with. You know, now you pop the balloons and you pull down the streamers and the celebration is over. Imagine if that candidate couldn't say, you know, the next election cycle, I'll be back, because they were stone cold dead in the tomb. I mean, that was the Christian movement. There was nothing at all left. The women didn't go to meet Jesus. They went to anoint his body. The guys were holed up in lockdown out of fear and shame for their behavior, unless they be crucified and killed as well. And yet, 40 days later, after a series of resurrection appearances, Paul describes in 1 Corinthians 15, he stakes the whole Christian movement on the reality of these moments with more than 500 people. He names names so they could be questioned. After 40 days, somehow, this little movement, it's fewer people that are in the balcony. Look back. It's fewer people, the Christian movement, that are in that balcony right now. A small number of people like that were spreading like no other movement in human history. They were overcoming opposition, first from Jewish synagogues, then from the great Roman Empire with its armies, its administrative state. They were overcoming obstacles, like the obstacles of different languages and different regions and different cultures. And lo and behold, pagans, pagan paupers and pagan princes, skeptics and intellectuals, loose livers and libertines, sinners were becoming saints one by one all across the globe. So as we sit here today, 2 millennia later, there are billions of little Christs and little Caesars as a pizza chain. I want to show you a little picture up here. This is just a little example of some of the connections we have with people you wouldn't expect. These are 10 men and women from Malawi who grew up in extreme poverty, poorest nation in the world. They got some education through a ministry called Urban Promise International. They decided not to maximize that here in the Western America, but to go back. They have each started ministries across that country. And together on this day and every day in the year, they are touching the lives of over 7,000 young children and teenagers. That word spread, how do you explain it? It's highly unlikely. How unlikely? And so is the impact, friends. So is the impact. How could you imagine this little, very specific group of Jewish men and women would somehow leave a legacy across the globe of music and art and architecture? That followers would build the first hospitals, start the first hospices, the very first universities. That some of them would introduce a new attitude of equality into the world, in a hierarchical world, that would eventually influence the rise of democracy, the universal franchise. That they would change fundamentally the way the world looked at the exploited and the victims, because their hero was an exploited victim. They would start movements of emancipation and liberation. So here's the question I'm leading to. What do you deduce, Sherlock Holmes of the world? What do you deduce from this astounding fact that the most adored leader in history was the most unlikely one of all? I'll remind you of our principle. When you've eliminated the impossible, what remains, no matter how unlikely, it's the truth. Now, it's impossible that the Christian story would have evolved in the way it did unless the resurrection is true, unless Easter is always with us, unless the power and the presence of Jesus are real. It is impossible, isn't it, that a handful of dispirited and defeated Jewish disciples, the disciples of a dead rabbi, could spontaneously concoct in a single moment an unimaginable story of a single resurrection and create a conspiracy around that message that would bring them in direct conflict with their own nation and a giant pagan empire. and that somehow they would win an amazing victory and create a cross-cultural movement that would spread across the globe and last 100 generations, influencing things in every time and place. No, it's impossible. What explains the Christian experience, the Christian movement, is the very same thing that astounded the first witnesses and the first disciples. It's the living presence of a risen Jesus. It's his power with us. It is never the same old story. No, it's always Easter. You know, there were three men at a wake for a fourth man. They had been doubles partners for 10 years. They played together every week. And these three, you know, they shuffled by. You may have done this some point in your life, by the open casket to say goodbye, have a final moment with their friend. And then they were gathering in the mortuary to talk. And one of them said, you know, this is sobering for me. I started to wonder when I was in line what people would say about me as they walked past and saw me in my casket at my wake. And I hope they would say about me that he was a good friend and an honest man. He had good character. And the second one said, what an awesome question. I hope they would say something a little different, that I was a good father, good husband, that I love my community. They turned to the third man. They said, how about you? He said, I hope when they're walking by my casket, they look inside and say, oh my goodness, he's moving. You know, it's always Easter. It's always Easter. And that frees us from the most important fears that people have in life. All of us have the same three fears. Did you know that? We have a fear of those moments that are endings, that are partings, that are goodbyes, where someone is losing this thing that we call life. But yet when the Romans herded the Christians into the Colosseum to be sacrificed to the animals and the gladiators, they sang hymns of praise. When other people left the city of Rome, when the plagues came and there were thousands of people dying in the streets and people trying to get away from this terrible fate, the Christians stayed in the city to tend the sick and the infected because death had lost its sting. One of the great things about being a pastor is you're with people at the end of their lives. Other pastors will tell you this. You get to be with the young and the old as they face their final moments, and many of them shine with faith. They are filled with hope. We're meant to live free of these partings and to live a life of hope, fearless. I think the second big thing that we're afraid of, it's insignificance. We don't talk about it a lot. But that somehow at the end of our lives, it won't matter a lot. It won't have made much of a difference. But Easter frees us of that. Because we hear that Jesus is always going ahead of his disciples into Galilee, into Paradise Valley, into Scottsdale, into Phoenix. He's going ahead to meet you, so in your relationships, as a father, as a husband, as a friend, as a worker, you'll encounter him, you'll partner with him, you'll be part of the way he's restoring the world, encouraging people around you, blessing, healing, bringing the kingdom of God. That's significance, friends. You were born for that significance. And finally, the fear of intimacy. Whatever human being wants most of all, wants to be known and also loved, right? What is your most embarrassing memory of your dating years? Do you have one? I know mine. My now wife, Julia, we hadn't dated yet, and she took the first move. She invited me to come to a costume party at her college. And it was sort of a sideways date, because she invited me and told me to bring somebody, and it would be her and her cousin. You know, it was kind of a group thing. And I was excited about this possibility, so I went to one of my good friends. His name was Craig, South African guy. And I said, Craig, we've been invited to a costume party. They call it Fancy Dress in England. And it's at a girls' college. He's like, oh, I'm too busy. I don't want to go. You know, I'm doing this. I'm doing that. I said, come on. I need you to do this, brother. This is a bro moment. Come on now. You got a man up for me. And I said, besides, we can't help but succeed. There are 9 girls to every guy at this teacher's college. If you can walk and talk, you're a sensation. I guarantee it. And he said, wait, I have one more objection. Where are we going to get the costumes? I didn't bring that in my luggage from South Africa. I said, no, it's all right. I have called a local costumer, you know, for plays. We got to go over there. Hurry up. It's almost closed. We're gonna get outfits. And we found the last two. And we had to just choose by size. He was a big guy. I was a little guy. So he took the big outfit, which was a hairy Viking outfit, you know, like animal skins, a big hat with horns. You've seen those? I had to go in the somewhat less cool outfit of an English courtier, you know? I had, like, tights on and a tabard and funny hat. But okay, it was my idea I had to go in that outfit. And so we got on our bikes and we rode out to this, this costume party was miles away. People were hooting at us all the way. I mean, he almost turned back. We finally get there. It's now raining. We're looking around this campus. There's no signs where this party is. We finally hear the music. We burst through the doors, and there's a moment of exultation, because indeed the ratio was right. There were 90 women in this room and 4 guys, and I was psyched. And then he gave me a hard elbow to the ribs, and he said, "Do you notice anything?" And I said, "No." He said, "We're the only people in costumes, the only ones, a hairy Viking and a courtier in tights." But it was a test. You know, if the gal you're supposed to be with walks over and admits she knows you in that moment and invites you to dance, she might be able to put up with some of your much worse flaws later in life, as she's had to do, no doubt about it. Every human being has a longing to both be known, really known as we are, and also loved, and it's a problem. We all have flaws and difficulties and struggles and dark sides, and it means if we're fully known, we're not fully loved, and if we're fully loved, we're likely not fully known. It's the intimacy paradox. We have a fear. The more we'll know, the less we'll be loved. The more we're loved, the less we'll be known. But Easter changes this. What if the person who knows you better than anyone else, better than you know yourself, all your failings and your faults and your secret dark thoughts, he knows all of it. What if that person loves you more than you could ever imagine? I love that moment on the cross when this hardened Roman soldier, you know, his job is the death brigade. Imagine that day after day, watching people swear and suffer and yell and scream in the injustice and the anger of it all, right? And he's watching just another guy die and barely paying attention. But by the end of the moment, he said, "Oh, this was the Son of God." How does that happen? It happens because Jesus, while carrying the brokenness of the whole world, not only reached out to his mother and his best friend, to John and to Mary, and put them together as a new family, he not only talked to the other criminals who deserved their fates on those crosses, these terrible guys, giving them a little counseling in their final moments, but he forgave his enemies that had put him there. This is the only place in the whole world where perfect intimacy and perfect love coincide. We're loved without conditions or limits, at great cost, despite all of our flaws. And that's why this symbol of fear and intimidation has become the symbol of a new kind of life, a life we can know and we can share in him. Friends, I want you to walk away today knowing one thing. It is always Easter. We are freed in relationship with him from endings and insignificance and problems with intimacy. We are free for hope and for significance and for love. He is risen. Please rise if you're able for our final hymn.
We are going to finish off with 2 verses of Lift High the Cross. And then if you have ever sung the Hallelujah Chorus before, we welcome you to come up during the hymn and get some music up front and sing the Hallelujah Chorus with us.
Thank you.
Friends, it is always Easter, and because of that, as we go from this place, we can go knowing the living Lord goes with us, behind us to protect us, above us to watch over us, beside us to befriend us, within us to give us the gifts that cannot end of faith, hope, and love, and always before us to show us his wonderful kingdom, Easter way. And all God's people said.
Amen.